actually, exactly a year ago, on the 11th of October, we mentioned that our preference at the time was offshore property or to local property. So let's check what has happened since then. So local property has underperformed, and then offshore property has outperformed. So the SA listed property index, the SAPI, is basically flat over the last 12 months. So that, and then the all property index down about 7.2%. So the difference between the two indices is that the SA listed property index excludes UK exposure, so it doesn't have Hammerson into and capital and counties. So that's why the all property index is actually down more than the SA listed property index, all due to Brexit. So results on average have been worse than expected, largely due to the fundamentals have been weak economic growth. We've seen everybody revise down the economic growth. So it's been a challenge for the sector. That's why even the outlook probably not as exciting as we expected earlier on. Whereas offshore property has done very well. It's up about 18% in dollars year to over the last 12 months, and still quite strong as well year to date, and up 23% if you include the rand weakness. But setup is still like, but we'll touch on that a bit more later. So we'll focus more on the local property market. So when we talk about local property market, what are we talking about? So what we've done here is to split this slide into two sections. One that shows the exposure of South African property companies in South Africa. So we'll see that the retail space is about 56%, and then followed by office and industrial 17, and then 3% is other sectors, mainly residential and self-storage. So very big into retail. South Africans love spending, so that's what we've got, so many shopping centers, 56%. But then these companies have diversified over the last 10 years, and have moved more into the offshore markets. So South African exposure in the index when investing in JSE is only about 53%. So that means 47% is outside South Africa. And what is the majority there? We've got Eastern Europe making up 30%. So basically a third of the exposure when investing in these markets, the underlying exposure is Eastern Europe. And then UK about 2%, Western Europe 7%. So just to look at what's happened recently, as we mentioned that the results in general haven't been that exciting. We've seen basically probably two companies actually coming up with better than expected results. So that's MICE, that they're in Eastern Europe. They're focusing more on developments, mixed-use developments, residential, so the outlook is quite strong, they're looking about 30%. But I'm always cautious of developments until the property is actually done and finished. And then ATTAC actually benefits from that because they've got a big investment in MICE. That's why the outlook is 10%. So basically almost all the earnings outlook positive is coming from the exposure through MICE Eastern Europe. And the rest of the companies, they've been in line with expectations. So it's in line with toned down expectations. So unlike before, we can actually much higher numbers. And what you see now as well, if you look at the majority, probably about half, all below expectations. And some companies, mainly in the UK, they can't even give guidance because practically no one knows what's going to happen up in the UK. But so we found those numbers actually, there's no guidance at all. Whereas some of the local companies still about 18-26% and negative returns. So stock picking in this market, very critical to find the companies that will generate our growth over the next year or so. So what has caused actually the market volatility over the last couple of years or months? The big one has been the resilient stable of companies. But if you look at what's happened, we talked about it last year, were all the allegations. And most of them are the FSC's closing cases from Napier Castle. So there are three cases basically, insider trading, market manipulation, false and misleading statements. So what's outstanding now is basically within the resilient company, where it's basically about false and misleading statements, but not by resilient, it's about resilient. So like all the reports are coming out, that's where the investigations are. So as soon as that is done, hopefully soon, then we can move on and actually look at other options of the companies. It's been a big focus because this stable of companies, so stable anymore, is almost a third of the listed property sector. So the time when this happened, so the other 40% of the listed sector, that's why it's been that volatility. And then the other point is actually consolidation. So last year, over the last couple of months, everyone's been expecting to find smaller companies consolidate, and when they consolidate, it helps to boost the earnings growth, boost liquidity. But none of the deals actually have materialized. It's only one, which is Django and Arrowhead, and then others have been announced, but nothing actually happening. And the big one that the market is waiting for is Rebosis and Delta. They focus more on government offices, their share prices have fallen 80-90%, and the see actually what's going to happen there. And they say they're going to come up with a circular at the end of the month. And then Safari as well, they're looking to take them out private with the Comprop, paying out cash, paying a huge premium compared to Fairvest. So not much happening in terms of consolidation as expected. The other challenge for property companies has been operating costs. It's something that you also feel as well as individuals when you're paying more rents and taxes. And the biggest increase in terms of operating costs, you've seen them actually move from 20 rand per square meter up to almost 60 rand per square meter over the last 14 years. So basically, costs have tripled. And the biggest portion of that is municipal charges, that's rates and taxes. And that's probably likely to continue as well. So it puts pressure on property companies. And you can pass on the costs, but you can't pass all of them to our tenants, and that makes it difficult for these companies or tenants to operate other businesses, and then for landlords to push for rental growth, it becomes tougher. And the big one as well has been the office sector. Office sector is quite huge, as we mentioned, almost 30%. There's lots of vacancies, lots of new developments, and we're seeing big corporates moving from all the offices to new offices. So all the ones actually are left vacant. Just give you some examples. This one is Waterfront, almost done. It will finish by in January next year. That's the thing that they're moving from Madrid and vacating those buildings, and then taking up an amazing head office there as well by Allendale. And this one is in Rosebank. It's about over 30,000 square meters. It's currently about 30% let, so it's sitting at almost 70% of vacancies. So talking to Growth Point, they're saying they may actually get a big tenant who's going to take up all the space, but then coming from another building, so that creates vacancies elsewhere. Just give you an example, Sandton is a node, the vacancies about 20%. So it means one out of every five buildings is empty in Sandton. And so you need the market to grow. The current grow as well to pick up that space and then drive rental growth. So at this stage in the office market, probably next year or so, we'll still be in that phase where companies are moving from the older buildings to new buildings. So big question is actually what happens to vacant office space? There's actually a couple of uses. What you're seeing now is that there's emergence of flexible office workspace, co-working. And one of the biggest companies coming to South Africa has been WeWork. It's the biggest landlord outside the government in New York, in London, in Paris, in San Francisco as well. And they're looking to grow their space as well in South Africa. So that's one strand. They're opening soon in Cape Town. And the pictures are took in Rosebank, where they've taken occupation. And in the next month or so, they're taking up space at the old Discover offices, 155 West, I think. And that's helped to actually take up some of that space in the market. And so different kind of market dynamic where people love to be in this kind of environment where it's more flexible, short-term leases as well, costing almost like 30,000 rand per head per month, much cheaper than 5,000-6,000 if you actually be in the corporate office space. And so younger people, millennials, creatives, all events, they've got beer on tap there as well. We've got all these breakout areas. So it's very popular, it's picking up quite a lot globally. It's a huge concept in the global market. And then other buildings, we're seeing them actually being converted into residential. There's been lots of conversions to residential. But residential is tough because some of the buildings you can't, depending on the size of your floor plate, you can't actually add departments. So these two buildings, this is an old Sasu building because Sasu was moved to a new building, just demolished to build this residential. So the old upset building in Rosebank that it demolished as well to build a residential that's up for sale. And then some of the other offices where you can't let, it's up for rent as well. So it's seeing that activity happening in the office market. But still the vacancies are high at this stage. And the other issue has been over the last couple of months, a year plus, has been Edcon. So Edcon has been quite topical, and Edcon was actually on the verge of collapse, actually. If the lenders didn't come to the party, Edcon would have been out of business. And so lenders have come in, and they've agreed to a 41% rent reduction. So there's been two options. It's either you let Edcon fail, or you accept the 41% rent reduction. Someone said that they can't accept the rent reduction, they will go for equity. So we've seen companies like Liberty 2 Degrees of meaning their funds and they'll take equity instead of the Edcon. This is what we prefer, because we're in the property companies, we're taking equity in the retail of our funds. That's not what we prefer. So we prefer companies that actually rent, just take a paying once, 41% rent less going forward. And that's impacted the results in terms of distributions. So you can see the results are going to be showing lower distribution growth as a result of that, because most of the malls are anchored around Edcon. Edcon is the biggest retailer in South Africa. And then we had new malls actually open as well, with Mall of Africa, all the malls around us, and this mall is up almost 180,000 square meters. So it's the biggest mall in the continent, and you've seen actually some of the tenants sort of feeling that. Some of the tenants have moved from the older section, like Edgar's. This place is vacant here to move to the section as well. But that creates extra space in the retail market, and it takes out some of the shoppers when you're going to Web Sandton or into Waterfall as well. So our market is not growing, but we've got more shopping centers is coming up, and that drags up down a rental growth in these markets. But not all the centers are struggling. I find that in our portfolios, we prefer exposure to the townships, to the rural areas, or non-metropolitan areas. So the pictures we took on social media in Pretoria, so this mall is achieving 7.4% year-on-year sales growth. And I took these pictures actually on the Sunday afternoon about 1:30. Parking was full, ATMs were full, everything's been as well. So that segment of the market remains stronger compared to the bigger malls. And to give an example, we've got Canal Walk in Cape Town, we visited in about 2-3 weeks ago. So about 150,000 square meters, the biggest mall in the Western Cape. The sales growth over the last 12 months has been flat, and food comes flat as well. So all of the low inflation, which makes it difficult for landlords to get rental growth when the sales for the tenants are flat. The market that we like at this stage is the industrial sector. Industrial sector in South Africa has moved away from manufacturing. We don't manufacture new things in South Africa, to more warehousing and logistics. And that's a segment that's doing very well. Vacancies are lower at about 3-4% on average. And one of the companies we like in the portfolio would be Equites. They reported today, and the results, they achieve about 9% distribution growth, and the outlook is 8-10%. So national average about 4% vacancies, and their portfolio's got 0.2% vacancies. So if in the right sector, you can still achieve a good earnings growth or share price growth. But yes, it's positive, but that's not enough actually to help the sector to achieve positive like-for-like net operating income growth. So what we've done here, we split this, just look at just from the portfolio's perspective, exclude funding or interest rates and that, how are the portfolios doing? So funds in 2015, the portfolios are achieving 5.4% net operating income growth. That's been trending down to 2.7%. So it's a portfolio on average. Then look at the leases coming up for renewal as they expire. 2015, 3% rental growth. Now it's actually trending down to almost 4% negative in 2019. So for landlords, it's better to keep the tenant than to actually let the tenant go, because it costs you a lot of money to get a new one, to do the fit out as well. So what the company is doing now is just to miss actually some of the struggling tenants and rather not give away that space to somebody else. But what's helping the sector as well is the diversification mentioned earlier on, that you've got Eastern Europe, we'll talk about that later on. But you find that UK, if you didn't have UK exposure, you've done very well over the last year. So UK companies, on average, not achieving any growth. Hammerson's been flat. We find it negative, and then even to saying 100%. But it's only that because they've opted not to pay out the dividend or distribution because of the high loan-to-value ratios, and the malls not doing so well, being affected by online shopping. So on the left-hand side, we're looking at Mass, we're looking at about 30% earnings growth, and then CRS, that's German-focused, and then Napier, the market as well, is in Eastern Europe. It's done very well over the years, achieving about 10-15% distribution growth, but you can't achieve 10-15% forever, so we're looking at that number coming down to 5-6%, which is still a strong number in euros in Eastern Europe. And then Investing Australia, they're investing in offices and industrial in Australia. So there are companies actually that just continue to do well in this market. UK is quite a big gamble because, as I mentioned, even the companies themselves don't know what's going to happen over the next 12 months. So as a result, you've seen, given the concerns in the market, the property sector falling in terms of NAV, 15% discount in net asset value. there's long-term average properties to trade 10% above your net asset value. So someone mentioned that earlier on, but it creates a good entry point if you take a long-term view, because you're not getting physical assets at 15% below what they're worth. But then why do sector trade at 15% below net asset value? It means the market is thinking that the capital values are going to fall. And look at the predictions over the next 12 months to 24 months or so, we probably expect cap rates to go up 50 basis points to 100 basis points. So when cap rates go up, it means property values come down. And looking at that, the retail sector is going to be most affected, coming from about 6.5, and seeing those rates moving up 100 basis points. Much because of competition, lots of oversupply as well, outcome issues, and even Maxcut as well. So Maxcut is one of the tenants we're watching out for. We're looking to cut our space as well. That's Game and DMY, and we need less space in some of the malls. So watching out for that. And then offices, mainly because of oversupply as well, you see that trending downwards. So expecting capital values to fall probably about 10-15%. And we believe that the set is priced in that, given the 15% discount to net asset value. But if it comes to values fall, the challenge is that your debt remains the same. Assume your debt is flat, but then the capital values come down, it means the loan to value ratio goes up. And at this stage, the property sector is sitting with loan to value of about 39%, almost 40%. 40% is basically the cut-off point from property companies. So above 40%, you start getting concerned. Even the rating agencies as well, like Moody's, they will actually downgrade actually the debt if you're above 30%. So we're watching out for that for the sector. But in terms of banks, it's different, because banks, you look at individual assets, and the bank covenants are only between 50 to 60%. So it means property values have to fall by as much as 25% to breach debt covenants. So from that perspective, still safe, but you have to watch out for the 30% loan-to-value ratio. We also look at the interest cover ratio as well. We don't have the slide here. That's one thing to watch out for as well. That has to be about 2x for property companies. At this stage, there's only 2 companies which are in breach of that, sitting below 2%. And we actually don't invest in those kind of companies. So there are other options. What do you do when the loan to value is 40%? So it's either you raise equity, so to get to reduce your loan to value ratio and finding acquisitions, but the appetite for equity has come down quite a lot. So property at the peak in 2014, companies could raise as much as 63 billion rand from investors through book loans, equity raises, rights issues. But the numbers come down to only 7 billion. Last year was quite quiet year with 6 billion, and that was 7 billion. So it makes it difficult for companies to look for new opportunities when the debt levels are high, and then can't get equity from the investors. So it's a fairly challenging period, and what we're seeing now is that most of the companies that can raise equity, the companies only going to the offshore markets. If you're looking to buy local portfolios, most investors are not interested. So you've seen investors in Australia, equities buying industrial in the UK, and then Australia as well in the UK, and some companies in Eastern Europe. So that's where most of the money's been going to. Actually, if you look at this chart here, almost 80-90% of the money raised here has gone overseas. It's gone to Australia, it's gone to Eastern Europe, it's gone to the UK. So if you can't raise equity, what do you do now then? Then it's okay, I'll probably sell some assets. And what property companies have been doing is that they've been net buyers of assets, looking for opportunities in South Africa. Like 2015, they bought about 27 billion of assets, and then 11 billion and 10 billion. And then 2018 and 19, they're net sellers of assets. So they can reduce actually their debt levels, use the cash as well to pay off the debt, and then reduce their loan-to-value ratios. So that's what's happening in the sector. So we say this trend is likely to continue in 2019-20, but the biggest challenge is that who is going to be buying those properties as these property companies need to sell, whether it's drop fund or lean fund. So you need some private capital to come in and buy some of these assets. So we're watching out for those trends. So then what happens, you can't sell the assets as well, you can get liquidity, the other options are not to pay out some of the profits. So property companies on average, actually not average, actually all the time, we pay out 100% in South Africa, whereas in the global space seems to be about maybe 80% payout ratio, we are retained 20%. South African traditionally we pay about 100%, but now we're seeing early signs of companies saying I need some money to help me, I service some debt, to do some maintenance, because I can't get more debt, I can't sell some assets, I can't raise equity. And we've seen with bosses, they've been affected by UK exposure and some of the local portfolios. They skipped actually the interim distribution. They didn't pay out anything to investors in the first half of the year. And then they also cut their payout ratio from 100% to 75%, like moving 25%. And then accelerate their own followers more. They're reducing their payout ratio to 95%. And then the challenge one is probably Redefine, which is the second biggest property company in South Africa after Growthpoint. They've signaled that they may reduce their payout ratio from 100 cents to 90 cents, as an example. And that's a challenge that as an investor, getting less income, and that causes capital volatility. So watching out for that. And the market is starting to price that in. So you find that property in general tends to trade over time in South Africa has traded below the bond market. So this is the property yields over time. And over the last couple of years, you can see that property investors are willing to accept a much lower yield versus bonds because they're getting the growth. So, but now it's changing back to where property yields are trading above the bond yields. Someone mentioned that briefly as well. So that means the market is pricing that risk as well. So the market is much more risky, but there's an element of compensation for that as opposed to previously where you actually had huge growth coming through. So this can come back to the pre-2005 levels, where our economy was actually not growing as much as we did, and so the market slowly pricing some of that. But what's been helping the sector is Eastern Europe. As I mentioned, Eastern Europe is 30% of the listed property sector. And this market, whether it's Romania, Slovakia, from Poland, from Bulgaria, Hungary, those markets are continuing to grow. GDP growth are positive, but we can say on average about 3% GDP growth. And some markets grew by about 4%, Poland at 5.5% at some point. But 3-4% GDP growth in this environment is a good number. For us, we can't achieve even 1%. So from a GDP growth perspective, that means it's actually drivers for this property market. It helps to drive our demand. So not only that as well, more and more people are getting employed in Eastern Europe. In those markets, average unemployment rate seems about less than 5% or so, compared to us at 30%. So as more people get employed, get in the job market, and they spend, and it helps drive the nodes, drives occupation, the offices, industrial activity as well. That's why we remain positive in Eastern Europe. We've seen lots of growth, but relatively speaking, Eastern Europe continues to help the listed property sector. And our models are standing up is that you have to understand what you're investing as well. So you see all these models, we take all these pictures, walk through all the centers, get a sense of how they're trading as well. So on average, they're about 99 to 100% net. And they're achieving sales growth of 6 to 7%, and some of them even 8%. So that's the trip that we did in June, when we went to Serbia, Lithuania, Hungary, Poland, Romania as well, did like 8 countries in about 4 days. So times we do like 3 countries in a day. I have breakfast in one country, lunch in another, and then dinner somewhere else as well. And in fact, actually, this one didn't start in the evening until about 9:30 because we've been traveling across some of all these countries in a day just to get us in what's going on. Because for us, we believe in that when we invest in these companies, we have to don't rely on Google images. That's why all our presentations, there's not even a single thought from Google or from the companies. It's us working through these models, get a sense of how they work, how they operate, the quality of these models, the condition, how busy they are as well. And one interesting thing about these models, they're quite huge as well. Look at the levels as well, sitting about 4 levels. In South Africa, anything above 2 levels doesn't really work. So I don't know whether because they're lazy to go to 3rd floor or 4th floor as well, but these models actually are doing very well, as I mentioned, 100% net across different markets. So now we talk about the returns. What do we expect in this market? As a listed property sector, over the first year, we're not looking at exciting returns, still going to be a tough year over the next 12 months. So you have to ride it out over the next 12 months, and our outlook is saying maybe about 4% probably total return on our base case, bearish case flat, and then bull case 8% or 9% total returns. Why is that? Because we've cut our earnings growth outlook or distribution growth to flat. Whereas over time, the property company has been growing about 4-5%, 6%, but now there's no growth at all. If you take out Eastern Europe off your exposure, So African property companies were delivered negative 5, 6 to 7% growth. So negative. So thanks to offshore, because we're still having to get a flat number. But if you're a long-term investor, you don't have to time this market as well. You're probably looking at this number coming up to about 11% annualized to 12% over the next 4 years. And distribution growth improving from 0.5% to 3.5%. So sort of the same goes for 10-15% growth. It's a lower growth environment at this stage. So that's the local property market, cautious over the first year, and then probably ride it out over the next 4 years. Moving to global property, now we're talking about developed property markets. What we do at Sandic, as I mentioned briefly, is that all the markets that we invest in, whether it's Australia, Japan, we travel everywhere together since what's going on. Each of the companies have one-on-one meeting sizes as well. Just give an example, 2019, these are the countries that we invested, and this is lots of Eastern Europe as well. So before you invest in any company in our portfolio, we have to visit the assets, get a sense of what's going on. And we've got other trips as well to Germany and as well as the UK. So it's offshore markets. And how do offshore markets look like? They're quite different to the South African market. Let's focus on the left-hand side. If you invest in a global property fund, what exposure are you getting? You're getting about 61% US. And then Japan is now overtaken Nikkei as the second biggest property market in the world in terms of REITs, whereas Nikkei used to be number two, but thanks to Brexit, it's just fallen quite a lot, followed by Germany. And then you get exposure to some of these other countries, Australia about 3%. So quite well diversified, but huge concentration on the US. In terms of sectors, much more sectors in this market. Residential quite big. In South Africa, about 92%, whereas globally, it's about 17%. We like the sector that we've gone to 25% in our portfolios for residential exposure. And then our self-storage quite big as well. Industrial, we've got healthcare 9%, and then specialty quite different ones as well. We've got data centers, we've got prisons as well. We can invest in prisons actually in the global property market. What I said that you can lock in your tenants for some time and then repair the rent. And then retail quite smaller, about 19%, come down from the 30% actual levels, and our portfolio were underweight retail, it's one of our biggest underweight positions, mainly because the retail sector is going through a lot of changes. So let's talk about some of the stocks. You may not be familiar with some of the stocks, but just give you a sense of what we invest in, what we like in those markets. The industrial sector is probably the best sector to be in over the next couple of years. And the biggest companies that you can invest in, Prologis, that's the biggest industrial company in the world, followed by Goodman, then Seagull, and then residential. Why do you like residential? It's mainly because people are moving away from like suburban areas into the CBDs. So most of our residential is a mixed-use development in the CBDs. And then if you're in the CBD, you see you're living in a smaller place now. And what do? You need actually storage facilities. So we've got huge exposure to storage. And these are the US companies, extra space in public storage. Like in the US, quite a lot of people use storage. And then big yellow in the UK. Even in Brexit, this company is doing well. Because some of the businesses, smaller businesses use self-storage as well. And in the UK right now, all the warehouses are full because all the companies are actually piling up, stockpiling as well in case Brexit happens. So you want to be actually in logistics. And that's a company we invest in the UK, Seagro, plus Big Yellow. And then large offices as well, mainly attended by big corporates. There's still huge demand for offices across most of these markets. So talking about self-storage, it comes back to that point I mentioned earlier on that you find that Americans, probably about 87, only 2.5% used self-storage, and now it's going to about 8%, and then it's going to go up to 10% or so, given the shift in how the way our people live. Younger people, millennials as well, we want to be in this kind of space. And all and above that as well, smaller businesses doing online shopping, deliveries as well, they use some of these facilities, and there's still huge room for our consolidation in these markets. So we love self-storage. And then offices, unlike in South Africa, offices are actually a different space globally. So vacancies are coming down in most of the markets. And South Africa, as I mentioned, sometimes 20% are vacant, whereas like in the US quite higher, but we prefer like in European markets as well as global about 10%, because the older offices difficult to convert. But we see actually rental growth averaging about 3% in hard currency over the last 5 to 7 years. So still solid growth is coming out, whereas locally still getting negative rental growth of up to 10% in the office market. And I talk about industrial sector, record low vacancies in the industrial market, and 4%, 5%. So you always have vacancies in this market, because as market shifts into more logistics, high-tech, warehousing as well, you can't use the older buildings for that. You need to build something new that works well for the new technology. And rents are growing by about 5% record highs in terms of rental growth. Because 5% may sound exciting, but we're talking about markets where inflation is 0 or 1%. So 5%, very solid number that we're picking up in the logistics space. But is that sustainable? We believe so. So if you look at how online shopping has changed over time, look at China. Look at China in 2008, online shopping was basically, there was no online shopping in China. But now almost 35% of our sales go through online in China. And then benefits from that, through the companies we invest in Hong Kong and Singapore, all those logistics companies as well, do well. And US continues to accelerate now and focus at 2021-22 to almost 22-23% online shopping. And then if you look at the cost of that, doing that, most of the cost actually is not actually warehousing. Warehousing is only 5% of the total supply chain cost. So the biggest cost is actually transportation and labor. And if you talk about warehousing as well, you can't just build a warehouse anywhere in the bush or too far. People want to be as close as possible to where people live. And online shopping has changed. Whereas a couple of 5 years ago, people were helping 3 to 4 days deliveries, but people now want overnight deliveries. They want same-day deliveries as well. So you have to choose the companies with the right locations where they can deliver that. So we believe this number is actually very sustainable going forward, given this trend that continues to go up. So I think online shopping is about 2%, growing about 10-15%, but quite small. It's difficult because in South Africa, if you don't have the post office, like in Australia, everything's done through Australia Post. You don't get, but as can imagine if you order something that goes through the post office as well. So things you can probably get lost. Put on transaction in the post office, where these markets the post office really works. Store closures in the retail sector, it's mainly because of that growth in online shopping. Well, in the US, let's say 2 years ago, almost 8,000 stores closed down. And then this year, probably going back to that level. We thought last year was going to get better to about 4,900 stores. Now it's getting better than to almost 8,000 stores closing down. And online shopping has actually impacted that. It's mainly the weaker malls, the ones that less quality ones, less dominant ones as well. If retailers look to close shop, they're closing the weaker stores. And the UK is probably not as bad as we thought. So you find that most of them, so we call them CVAs. In the UK, if you are struggling with a tenant, you just say, no, I can't pay the rent. It's called company voluntary arrangement or agreement as well. So it's actually the law favors the tenants. So then we found that there's lots coming up, but most of it's probably closed shop. It's only those bigger places and coffee shops that have all opened as well, and there's too much competition that are closing our shop. So maybe watching out for that, that's what we prefer the industrial exposure in our portfolio. It's important as well to look at the malls, because everyone says this is really oversupplied in terms of malls, but it depends what you invest in the US. We still have actually retail exposure from companies like Simon Property Group. So investing in the US, you want to be in the A-grade malls, just like your premium malls that you find in South Africa, and then avoid all these other retail as well. We call them power centers, all these smaller centers outside. So we focus on the A-grade malls. So yes, we've got quite a lot of malls, and South Africa ranks at 11th or 12th in the world in terms of shopping center space. Per capita, but you don't have the same amount of spend as the company like Sweden or Spain or Italy or Netherlands or Germany. That's sort of negative on the retail space in South Africa. So we travel as well, just get a sense, look at some of those models that have been traveling across the world. We had a conference at the beginning of the year for the City Conference. And then after the conference, we try to get a sense of what's going on. And you can see the number of department stores that have closed shop in the US. So like a Sears has closed down, and then there's no one taking up the space now. It's actually a children's play area there as well, from the department store to toys and games. That's quite a challenge. But so some of the vendors are looking to sell some of those malls, and there's not many buyers for some of the malls. So one guy was joking, because South Africans are buying lots of offshore portfolios. They said maybe we can sell it to South Africans, because South Africans really got huge appetite for offshore property. But that's not the quality that we'll be looking for. So as a result, the retail sector globally, you've seen actually investment volumes fall as much as 20%. So less appetite for retail going forward. But there's still record amount of capital chasing our property assets, mainly actually the industrial, the storage, logistics related, offices as well, co-working, and Blackstone, which is actually a private fund, which is actually the last ever fund, $20 billion in earnings, including the amount of unspent capital, so that's $350 billion actually globally looking for opportunities as well, but probably less retail, other sectors as well. And that's good for our sector because there's buyers outside actually the listed space. Whereas in South Africa, as I mentioned, the challenge is there's no buyers outside the listed property companies. So given that, you've seen the property companies trading above net asset value in the global space. So we're seeing trading 15% below net asset value, whereas globally, the shares are trading about 5% above what the assets are worth. So which makes sense. If you've got the capital chasing the assets, you've got the fundamentals, we have the rental growth, and we believe that numbers are actually fairly reasonable, and more so given the low interest rate environment. And earnings growth is still actually good. Positive, we're seeing about 5% earnings growth over the next year in the global markets in hard currency. We're looking for flat. And earnings growth tends to track our GDP growth. So you find that there's a lag as well. So when GDP growth accelerates, property actually lags the GDP growth in, by a year, 6 months to a year. So the lag in the recovery and the lag as well in decline. So what's happening now? So like in subprime crisis, GDP growth declines, probably declines like 6 months or so later on. So right now we're in a market where GDP growth can slow down, and we believe property is actually a better investment call compared to say equities, because equities fairly impacts immediately. If you cancel anything because the market is weak, your profits are weaker as well instantly. Whereas property is doing 8-year leases, 7-year leases as well. And what you're finding that early signs of that is that GDP growth is slowing down globally, including this, but yet property companies still flat in terms of earnings growth because of those long leases, annual escalation as well, some of them align with the inflation. And so we love these markets. And look at yield gap as well. US across the world as well, we find that the yield gap stayed the same. So this is actually the dividend yield for the US property companies. You get about 4% yield. So 4% yield and your spread is about 2%. So you're getting 2% above in US 10-year bond yield. Whereas our spread is much lower. And if you go to Japan as well, the yield is almost 4%. UK about 4% yield, and then continental yield about 5% yield compared to bond yields in Germany during the negative or flat. So you're getting 5% above those bond yields. That's what makes this market actually more attractive than the South African property market. So once we've done all the work, we've done the site visits, we look around, we meet the companies, we do our modeling as well, we come up with our numbers, we're looking at about 5% earnings growth for the global property markets. So all these numbers are in dollars. And then our assumption that the next 10 year bond is at 2%. But if the next 10 year bond goes on to 1.5%, which is a possibility, because some of us are talking about the 10 year bond going to as low as 1%, then we can still get those strong double digit numbers. But the fairly conservative, meaning about 2% and then 10% annualized returns in dollars. And then in 4 years, yes, the world's going to slow down. So our earnings slow down from 5% to 4%, which is still a very good number on a 4-year basis, annualized, and our total returns about 9%. So we've done this work in the framework over time, and 80-90% of the time has been fairly spot on, more so in global property space in terms of predicting total returns. So to conclude, we prefer offshore property to local property. In the local property space, there's still opportunities as well to have offshore property exposure. As I mentioned, offshore is 47%. So how do we invest in our portfolios? We want to be overweight companies with some offshore exposure, as opposed to actually going 100% local exposure, given that our economy is going to take at least 2 years to really recover. So that balance is very important in making those investment calls. So local property, looking at 10-11% yield at some point. So probably say don't dive in, it's too early to dive in, but you can actually dip your toes or feet as well and start buying and look at these opportunities when it's good yields, because the market is looking cheap right now. It's just left to wait to see what happens to loan to value ratios, to the payout ratio as well, to the NAV as well. Most of that actually slowly being priced in. Whereas globally, we'll be cautious that the returns have been very strong. As I mentioned, 18% returns in dollars. Even year to date as well, still strong double-digit returns. So look beyond 1 year, because once you've made 18% returns, market returns will be volatile. So rather actually take a number 10 view. So that's our property story. I'll be happy to take any questions.